So I would like to introduce Paul Scharre. Last week, when we were getting ready for this conference, my colleagues Ray Yanello and Patricia Rexter were talking about Paul Scharre because we couldn't get a hold of him. And suddenly, Patricia says, oh my gosh, he's on NPR, and he's in Europe. He's just really busy. So yes, he is. He is an impressive person. And when I talked to him about introducing him, he also impressed upon me that he's very modest. He only wanted me to talk about a couple of things. Well, first of all, Paul Scharre is a fellow and director of the 20YY Warfare Initiative at the Center for New American Security. From 2008 to 2013, Mr. Scharre worked in the Office of Secretary of Defense, where he played a leading role in establishing policies on unmanned and autonomous systems and emerging weapons technologies. Prior to joining OSD, Mr. Scharre served as a Special Operations Reconnaissance Team Leader in the Army's 3rd Ranger Battalion and completed multiple tours in Iraq and Afghanistan. He is a graduate of the Army's Airborne, Ranger, and Sniper Schools, an honor graduate of the 75th Ranger Regiment's Ranger Indoctrination Program. Mr. Scharre holds a Master's in Political Economy and Public Policy and a Bachelor's of Science in Physics cum laude, both from Washington University in St. Louis. On Twitter, Paul is self-described as a robot geek. So please give him your undivided attention and be prepared to ask him swarms of questions when he concludes his presentation.
That's good. I just want to clarify time. Until 11? Okay, great. Okay, thanks. Everybody hear me okay? And you guys are getting me on the mic? Okay, great. Thanks. So what I want to do is just talk a little bit about a project we have underway at the Center for New American Security looking at robotics and autonomous systems. Feel free to interrupt if you have questions, and then I'll try to leave some time for questions at the end as well. The project that I'm running, let me first give an overview of the center in case you're not familiar with this. Center for New American Security is an independent, bipartisan institution, a think tank here in town, non-for-profit, dedicated towards bold, pragmatic, bipartisan national security solutions. A lot of the work we do is on defense, not exclusively. We have folks working on Middle East and Asia, national security, foreign policy issues, and certainly renewed attention to Russia these days. This project in particular was started by now Deputy Secretary of Defense Bob Work when he was at CNAS about a year and a half ago. Motivated by a lot of the same ideas that are driving him now in DoD to talk about an offset strategy, defense innovation initiative, long-range research development planning, to try to really think about where is emerging technology going to influence how we fight and how others fight in ways that we have to respond to. Really with a focus on sort of what are the operational implications in terms of con ops and capabilities. So you'll have to apologize. Some of this didn't import well from a Mac, so there may be some weird slideology things here. But some recent reports we've done, a big focus of our effort has been on robotics and autonomy. That's not exclusively what we're doing. We just released a report last week on directed energy weapons. We've done some work, including by some outside authors in the audience, Andrew, on exoskeleton technology, and have other kind of projects underway. But robotics autonomy has been a big focus. This paper in particular I want to sort of highlight, tucked in the corner here, written in January of last year, was written by Bob Work. And to let folks in on a secret, unlike a lot of things in the think tank world that are written by a junior staffer and then someone senior puts their name on it, was actually written by the Deputy Secretary. It's really encapsulating his vision of what robotics and autonomy could do in future battlefields. Certainly, I think, worth a read given sort of his position now and some of the things that he's been talking about. All right, so when we've looked at this problem, we kind of asked a couple of questions. First of all, what are the challenges that the joint force has today, particularly in terms of things like operating at longer range in anti-access areas? Certainly, this is the case in air and at sea, but also will increasingly be the case in ground operations, when enemies have access to increasingly capable anti-tank guided missiles, manned portable air defense systems, guided rockets, artillery and mortars, and cheap drones that can come after our troops. How do we deal with a long-term, multi-decade trend in rising platform costs that is driving down quantities? And for the Army in particular, this is really, this is certainly the case on major combat assets like tanks and ground fighting vehicles, but it's also the case for personnel in a way that's really acute for the Army in a way that it's not necessarily for the services, because personnel is such a big chunk of the Army's budget and a driver of size and force structure. Rising personnel costs are also driving decreased size of the Army. How do we address rising costs? Are there ways to sort of bend the cost curve more intelligently? How do we manage the deluge of data that's coming in from all of these sensors that we have on the battlefield? Make sure the right information gets to the right people. It's not stuck in a talk somewhere. And then how do we keep pace with an accelerating pace of battle, particularly when others are going to be able to target our forces with precision, with swarm attacks from missiles, from rockets, from small drones that could overwhelm our ability to respond? So we want to look at how does autonomy help us address these and other existing challenges? How can we seize new opportunities? And then how can we anticipate the nasty things that others will want to do to us and prepare for those? So to kind of give a brief overview of this concept here, I want to just be clear on sort of terminology. So I'm going to talk about robotics, talk about autonomy. I think it's worth separating out the benefits of taking a person off of a platform or a vehicle versus autonomy, which are two separate things, right? You can have lots of autonomy in things where you have people on them, like a modern automobile that has intelligent cruise control, automatic lane keeping, collision avoidance, increasingly features that will allow the car to really drive itself most of the time. And you can, of course, have them on vehicles that don't have people in them that allow you to operate in communications degraded environments or denied environments where you don't have comms. This is already being done underwater today, where people have put autonomous vehicles undersea that have operated for years at a time, gliders that can tap into thermal power from the thermoclines and stay at sea fully autonomously without communications for years, just surfacing from time to time to link up to a satellite. How can you increase safety and reliability? And then how can you increase the ability to operate at speed to respond to very rapid events? And taking a person out of a vehicle can give you all sorts of other performance advantages. The ability to take more risk with that asset, reduce size, weight, increase maneuverability, increase speed. This is particularly relevant for the Army when you start thinking about ground vehicles. We are basically at the limit of physics today when we look at future ground vehicles and the ability to make a vehicle that has the protection that we want, but also the mobility that we're looking for. And absent some major breakthroughs in material science, we really just don't know how to do that. What this allows you to do is envision vehicles that do not have people in them, that might be lighter weight, more mobile, not armored, take greater risk. With more autonomy, you can operate them in communications-degraded environments and maybe do interesting things operationally. This is an example of here's a boat driving itself with nobody on board that the Office of Naval Research demonstrated in August of last year in a swarm demonstration. They had a fleet of boats. Let's see if I have a picture. Here we go. Here's a full picture of them. Five boats operating. There's one off camera here. In a swarm to intercept a potential threatening vessel that was coming towards a boat that they were doing a mock protection of, and then respond autonomously. All right, so how do we do what we're already doing better? I think, to be frank, we're in a pretty good place on this. Across the department, we've had enough experience with unmanned systems and autonomy that people are in a pretty decent place about trying to think about improving what we're already doing. The Army is working on incorporating unmanned ground vehicles into ground logistics operations. We have manned unmanned teaming in aviation. So we're certainly using them in things like IED, counter IED today, and developments on small ground robotics that we use for reconnaissance for ground troops. people are sort of starting to wrap their minds around lower cost. How do I lower cost? Is it taking a person out of something that allows me to lower cost because I design it differently, because I make it cheaper? Is it autonomy that allows me to lower cost because I can reduce training for perhaps very expensive things, like maybe helicopter pilot training in the future, if I could increase greater autonomy? This is what I'm going to talk primarily about today, is how does this enable you to fight differently, or others fight differently in a way that you want to be able to respond to? The bulk of our research and our concern has really been about what is the sort of danger and the opportunity that some of this technology will allow a change in how we operate on the battlefield, right? Akin to innovations like the advent of the machine gun or the tank or the blitzkrieg in the past, things that we want to be able to anticipate, begin experimenting with, begin to develop first before we encounter it on the battlefield. All right, so I'm going to kind of preview some of the major highlighted conclusions here. These are not necessarily things that we came into this with the assuming this was the outcome, but these are things that I kind of want to at least plant in your mind now as I walk through this. So one is, I don't envision a future where we have, you know, robots loose on the battlefield and the people are all safely back in the States. I'm envisioning a mix of vehicles that have people in them and ones that do not. The key question is figuring out why, what's the advantage of each, right? If I'm going to put a person in it, what do I want to do? I would suggest one of the big advantages is communications. You don't have to rely on long-range communications. If you have people close on the battlefield, they can quarterback the fight with a mix of manned and unmanned vehicles, and shorter range, you still need comms, but shorter range comms is easier to do than long range comms. For a lot of the things, of course, that the Army will need to do, you'll want people on the ground, because what you'll have to end up doing is getting out of your vehicle and interacting with people. You're not going to send a robot to a tribal leader engagement. I don't see that as working in the near future, right? So if nothing else, we have people on the ground in sort of the places where the Army is going to be in the future for that reason. I also see a mix of human and machine cognition. I think sometimes there's this idea that we're on this path towards more autonomy, and at the end there's this point of full autonomy, and we're going to get there, these are fully autonomous things. I don't know what that means, full autonomy. We don't have people that have full autonomy. They have training, they have ROE, they have commander's intent. We certainly don't want to send a private out on the battlefield and say, do what you think is a good idea. We give them instructions. We keep usually a sergeant pretty close by to grab them by the scruff of the neck if necessary. Similarly, I see we're talking about a mix of things that might be automated and things where people are making decisions. And I'll make an analogy to cars. As we're seeing more features being incorporated into cars, there is some point in the future where you'll get into a car, and maybe it'll be 5 years, maybe it'll be 20 years, but you'll get into a car, and you'll tell the car where you want to go, and you'll take the hands off the steering wheel and don't do anything. Google's car doesn't even have a steering wheel. You're a passenger. But the person is deciding where the car goes. There is still ultimately some mix of the human giving the instructions, the human tasking the mission, the human warfighter, in our case, being responsible for getting the mission done. I see robots or unmanned systems or autonomous systems as things that are helping accomplish some tasks. But the person is ultimately responsible for the job getting done. And lastly, this is frankly less of an issue almost on the ground, because people on the ground, sort of this is like conceptually so far, people aren't even talking about it. But in air and space, it's a little bit different. But I see people ultimately still making the decision about use of force. I don't think on the ground it's even really conceivable to think about doing this from a practical standpoint. There are things maybe in air and at sea that you could technically do, but are probably unwise. So I'm assuming that people are still making decisions about what targets to engage. All right, so at a high level, what I'm going to suggest is that a military that is invested heavily in robotics and autonomous systems will move from fighting as a network today, where we have distributed forces that have communications that can operate across distances, to fighting as a swarm. So what does that mean? I'm going to suggest it means, this is where the conversion from a Mac to a PC really messed me up. All right, so this is not super helpful. We're missing a bullet. But I'm going to suggest it means five things. First is greater range and persistence of your military forces as a whole. When I take a person out of a vehicle, I can operate for very long periods of time, long endurance operations. This will allow you to operate at greater ranges and persist at those ranges with things like unmanned aircraft, unattended ground sensors, unmanned ground vehicles that you can send out on the battlefield that could stay out for days. For some things, if you solve the power problem, maybe ground sensors stay out for months at a time. More daring concepts of operation. You can do things, not just I put the robot out in front and take more risk with it, but now I change the concept of how I'm doing something because I can take more risk, right? So you can drop robots behind enemy lines to run amok like D-Days, little groups of paratroopers to disrupt the enemy. And if they're sacrificial, but they get the job done, that's okay. You could do things with them that we just would not do with people. You could put greater mass on the battlefield because you can build things at lower cost, because you don't have to build it to design it with a person on board, and because you have greater autonomy, you can have one person controlling many things, you could put large amounts of mass on the battlefield in a way that we have not seen, frankly, in terms of how the US fights since World War II, bringing mass back into the fight in a big way. We can operate with greater coordination intelligence once those systems are communicating and they're cooperative. So instead of just thinking of large numbers of things that are able to coordinate their behavior the same way that ants and bees and termites are able to. And what you're missing here is the advantage of speed. The fact that autonomy can help compress decision cycles, allow warfighters to process information much quicker, and in swarming behavior, push reactions on the battlefield closer to the battlefield's edge to accelerate the pace of reacting to the enemy. And we're going to walk through each of these and try to give some specific examples. Many of these are sort of joint examples. I'll try to aim towards some relevant Army ones. And if you have questions, sort of jump in. So range and persistence. So not limited by human endurance, you can operate things basically until you run into other limitations. Power becomes the next big one, generally speaking. The nice thing for the Army is when you have, say, a ground vehicle, you can do things like put a bigger gas tank on it and run it with gas, right? And things that are difficult to do, say, under sea, where you don't have the ability to use an internal combustion engine in an air. Novel sort of power solutions to keep things out for long periods of time. For aircraft right now, the unrefueled endurance record is 80 hours, was just set in December of last year with a conventionally powered aircraft. People are looking at novel power solutions like fuel cells that would actually blow that up significantly even further. Although the Navy just demonstrated last week autonomous aerial refueling that will allow us to basically push that as far as you want to go when you start looking at reliability or weapons expenditure or other things. The ultimate refueled endurance record for an aircraft is 62 days. 1958 to 59 over a period of 2 months, two guys flew a Cessna for 2 months in the air. I don't know why one would do that, but they wanted to break a record, and no one has decided they wanted to top that since then. This can translate to major cost savings advantages because you need fewer platforms in your force if they stay on the battlefield longer. It's particularly relevant for aircraft when you're operating at long ranges. As long-range threats push our bases further and further away, you're eating up a lot of time just in transit. So if a pilot in a fighter aircraft has a human endurance limit of about 8 hours to remain combat effective. At ranges of 1,000 miles of standoff, you're eating up half of that time just in transit. And so being able to keep something forward in the fight longer is both operationally relevant and can have cost-saving advantages. To give some examples here, this is shows aircraft operating out of Guam. The color's not really great here on the presentation, but these red ones would be 28-hour unmanned aircraft. These blue ones would be 12-hour manned aircraft. You see, if you want to operate from Guam, put up a 24/7 orbit over Taiwan, you need only two red ones, two unmanned ones, and 10 manned aircraft. That's a big cost savings difference. And then if you wanted to put orbits over Korea, or say off the coast of Korea, you can't even get there with a manned aircraft with 12 hours. You eat up all that time just getting there and getting back, so you can't loiter. So this can allow you to do things like power projection anti-access environments, build up airborne communications relays. This is particularly relevant for the Army in that you can envision an airborne layer of unmanned vehicles that transits with the Army on the move. Comms on the move, ISR on demand on the move, a self-healing network that can respond to ground forces, and potentially is adaptive to forces autonomously as they're moving on the battlefield. Can allow persistent surveillance particularly if you can build things leveraging commercial components that are not attributable to the U.S. government, right? So you can put things out on the battlefield ahead of time, and things that maybe if somebody finds it, there's no U.S. flag on it, there's no U.S. markings, and we don't know where it came from, because anybody could be building a small, cheap wave gliding robot on sea, or a drone, or a ground vehicle. There are certainly, just a couple weeks ago, pictures of unmanned ground robots in Iraq being operated by Shia militias. So not really tightly controlled technology. They're not super sophisticated, but they're robots, and they got cameras on them, and they got guns on them. All right, so more daring concepts of operation. If you do move into contact, let the robot make the contact, right? Let the robot go into the room first and take the bullet for you. Let the robot be at the vanguard of an advance and take the anti-tank guided missiles. This is potentially a way to think about operating in very high threat environments. And this is a little bit different, I want to be clear, from sort of some of the older concepts of sort of FCS and how we would put out all these unmanned things. We'd have information dominance. What this is really suggesting is a little bit different paradigm. Instead of saying I'm going to have people in these light-skinned vehicles because I'm going to have perfect information of where the enemy is, what this is really saying is I'm going to keep my people buttoned up because I don't know, and I'm going to try to get information, but I'm probably not going to have perfect information, and I'm going to get hit. But I'm willing to buy more mobility with unmanned systems and put them out in front and let them take that risk first. Let them be at the front of a movement to contact. Let them sort of stimulate the enemy and make the enemy react and expose themselves to that. There are examples of things where we do that today. The Air Force has something called a miniature air launch decoy, flies ahead of our aircraft to stimulate enemy air defenses. There's a jamming variant of it. It's a mission that used to be done by people. In Vietnam, the Wild Weasel mission was done by this. We had a person flying fast and low to stimulate enemy air defenses. Now we send, we don't really call it a robot, but it's a robot, right, to go do that. Seems like a smarter approach. Casualty evacuation, we can come back to this at the end because the Army has a very interesting position on this, but a great place where it's dangerous. There are places where we don't have the ability to get people in to evacuate because of the threat, and robots would be certainly very good at that. And then things like sending things that would be expendable to scout out ahead, or decoys to do feints and deception operations to confuse the enemy about what you might be doing. During the Iraq invasion, we had people doing this in Western Iraq, trying to simulate a left hook like we had done in Desert Storm, some special operations units, a couple armored units to try to create the illusion of a much larger force. But there was really clever things that you could do with unmanned systems, both because they're expendable and because you could do things with very deliberate signature emission in RF or other things to create actually the signature illusion of a larger force moving through an area. All right, mass. You could build large numbers of systems, make them expendable, make them cheaper, field them. The Army has thousands of Humvees and M113s in its inventory that it will not use in future fights because they're not survivable. But they would be survivable enough for a robot, right? There's nobody in them. And they could be used for scouting, for carrying weapons, for carrying cargo. With greater autonomy, you could allow one person to field many of them. So we need to get away from sort of a one-to-one approach we have today where a person's remotely controlling something. If you're going to do that, you can't really achieve this because you need a lot of people behind that, right? But once you start to break that apart, once you have one person controlling many things at the same time, you can put a lot of combat power on the battlefield. This allows you to disaggregate your combat power, which imposes costs on the enemy. It allows you to replace the concept of platform survivability with resiliency of the swarm. Maybe I don't care if my individual platform is survivable because I have a lot of them. And I look at, instead of the sort of the capability of that platform, I think about capability per dollar and how many can I buy. It allows graceful degradation of combat power because now instead of losing one very expensive thing, if I lose one or two or five of them, I've only lost half of them and I can keep fighting with the remainder. All right, so certainly lots of clever things you can do in the air. DARPA's doing some very interesting things. They've got a project called SOSITE, System of Systems. There's a really cool video online of swarms of air vehicles coming out the back of a cargo plane to do countering air defenses that are cooperative, that are possibly recoverable, possibly expendable, a very interesting way to think about countering enemy air defenses. You can also look at, you know, large numbers of low-cost drones. We don't really do it this way. We do things that are low-cost in the military sense, but 25 grand for like a Raven's not really low-cost, right? You could do things off the commercial market that are 3D printed that are potentially really, really expendable. And large numbers of them that you'd send into a building, say, to go after the enemy, to identify them. Now, if you're buying all these things, you've also got to worry about maintenance. It's more than just the operators. It's the people turning the wrenches on them. Who's going to turn the wrenches on all these Humvees if we're going to do that? There are ways to think about dealing with that problem. Modular design so that you can plug and play pieces of it as things break down to decrease the time effort spent to keep them up. Designing for things that can sit in a box, like missiles, for long periods of time and be used when they're needed. Or leveraging organizational solutions, leveraging multi-compo units that bring in reserve component maintainers so that you have people in the active force that would fight and leveraging the reserve component to do the maintenance if you needed to. Now, coordination and intelligence is a huge advantage here. Putting a lot of things on the battlefield is not a swarm. A swarm is cooperative behavior. It's things that are able to work together. So when you look at ants and bees, they're able to coordinate their behaviors through very, very simple mechanisms. None of them are individually very intelligent, but the collective behavior can be quite intelligent and quite responsive to emerging situations that they face. So you can do things like coordinated attack and defense. That swarming boat demo that ONR did was about coordinated defense. It was about having not just a number of vehicles out there, unmanned boats to protect a U.S. ship, but the ability for them to then respond under a person's direction, but then coordinate their actions to encircle a potential enemy and interdict further away, increasing standoff from the U.S. ship. This can be used to create sort of time-synchronized multi-vector attacks against the enemy, as well as cooperative defense. You can imagine a bubble of ground and air robots protecting a squad moving through a city. Things that are able to be in front, behind, overhead, looking around the corner, and able to do so autonomously so that the people on the ground, the squad members, know where they are. They have a heads-up display that allows them to know where these things are operating at, but they're not sticking them remotely, right? There's no way you could possibly do that. And of course, you don't want to give up people that have their heads down in the display. That's a big criticism today. So, all right, 5 minutes. I'll speed things up. So, dynamic self-healing networks are able to respond to the needs of people, whether they're tasking them for ISR, logistics, or other things. All right. So I'm going to zip through this part. What does this mean sort of doctrinally? Two fellows at RAND, John Arkea and David Ronfeld, made a pretty bold and interesting idea about a decade ago now in a paper talking about swarming in the future of conflict. And they argued that warfare has had four main doctrinal types over history, evolving from melee to mass to maneuver, and that the next evolution was going to be the swarm. All right, so in ancient times, people fought in a melee, think sort of Braveheart style, large numbers of individual people running around, hacking each other to bits. The first innovation doctrinally was fighting in a mass. So things like the Greek phalanx that allowed people to rely on one another, fight as a cohesive element. Now, this was a superior way of fighting, but required better training, organization, better communication among the elements to achieve that. The next innovation was in maneuver warfare. So still things fighting as massed elements, but the ability for them to separate two different massed elements and maneuver on an enemy to get into a better position to outflank an enemy. Now, better, but also requires better communications, particularly across distances, better training, better organization to achieve this. And this is, you know, this is particularly relevant for how the Army fights today. I mean, this is, you know, I grew up in the world of the infantry. This is still what you do. You have people lifting and shifting fires and throwing star clusters. One of the limitations in this is you can't move too many things at one time because things start to get messy and fratricide starts to be a pretty big risk. So you try to minimize, you try to say you got one thing fixed, one group moving at one time, and that's it. Now, they postulated that the next evolution in warfare was the swarm, where you had large numbers of things like in melee combat, and then we're fighting cooperatively. And this would allow you to disperse and disaggregate when in a disadvantageous position from the enemy, but then converge on the enemy at the right time and place to achieve mass effects. This is really hard to do. This requires much higher levels of coordination, information processing, or it just ends up in just absolute chaos, and it disaggregates into melee combat, into just sort of a riot. Now, if you try to do this with people, think about all the information any individual person or squad would have to process. They have to know where everybody is all the time, or it's a recipe for disaster. There have been examples where non-state groups have done this in limited ways. One of the best examples is 2011 in London, when rioters were able to use the London BlackBerry network to communicate where police barricades were. And they had better information, better communication than the police did. And so the old tactic of hemming in rioters with barricades didn't work, because they could communicate very rapidly across a very decentralized network where the police were, and they could disperse, all acting autonomously on their own, and then reconverge to continue rioting and looting somewhere else. But this might be achievable with robots, because they could process larger amounts of information faster, and you could treat every individual element as sacrificial. And so if they got overwhelmed and cornered and you lost them, you could live with that. All right. This raises all sorts of interesting questions about command and control. I'm just going to say there are interesting questions here. There are different command and control paradigms. People are really interested. We could talk about it in Q&A. But how do you control a swarm? No one really knows yet. People are doing some interesting research at the ground level. Speed is important, can allow you to compress decision-making times and respond faster on the battlefield. You would want to worry that you're not getting inside your own OODA loop. How do you make sure that the robotic systems you've put out there are doing what you want them to do? They're staying within commander's intent. So obstacles and limitations are certainly technical ones. Power, autonomy, communications are certainly big. There are also institutional ones. Dollars is a big one. Right now, about 5% of DoD R&D and procurement dollars is spent on unmanned systems. Now, if they're like a niche thing in the future, that's probably about right. If they're potentially have the potential to really change how militaries fight, how others are going to fight, how we should, then that's probably not enough. Some of these raise doctrinal questions about how you operate, and there are cultural things. I'll leave some of this for the Q&A, but I'll just throw out there one interesting example from the Army. The Army medical community, I mentioned CASAVAC earlier, the Army medical community has written not one, not two, but three policy memos prohibiting casualty evacuation on unmanned vehicles. So they're not in favor of that concept. All right, so I think we're in the middle of some paradigm shifts from talking about unmanned to human-machine teaming, from full autonomy to operationally relevant autonomy, from individual platforms to thinking about a swarm. And that's kind of the crux of it. I mean, I think to encapsulate it, I don't envision a world where you have robots fighting. I don't think that paradigm makes sense. What I'm really thinking about is, how do people fight differently with a different tool at their disposal, just like things like rifles and machine guns and tanks and aircraft have changed how we fight. So thanks very much, and I think we got some time for questions.
I'm Tom Campbell. I'm the National Intelligence Officer for Technology with the Office of Director of National Intelligence. And so I'm curious, two things that you didn't really go into, perhaps I missed it, but one is the disabler potential of cybersecurity hacking of said swarms. And so we can envision having a swarm deployed and then having that swarm redeployed against ourselves through hacking. And then the other is an enabler, which could, in the context of the 2025 to 2040 vision we have for this event, make full autonomy much more possibility, and that's artificial intelligence. And I was wondering if you could comment upon those two points.
Sure. So on autonomy, I'm gonna hat tip to Andrew here. This is a term from him. I think when you think about autonomy, I like the term I'm going to steal from him, is of a cyber autonomy paradox, and it goes kind of like this, right? There's no reason that I can tell to think of unmanned systems as being more vulnerable to hacking. Anything that's networked is going to be vulnerable. If you've got a person in it, that's not going to change anything. But the difference is, as you alluded to, the consequences once you get in could be quite different, right? So if you have a joint strike fighter and there's a zero day in it and somebody gets in, we're probably in a really bad place. But if there's a person on board, they're probably not going to be able to take control of the aircraft and fly it on their own with someone who has physical access. But that could be the different when you have a lot of autonomy, right? So how do you think about protecting against that? I think we would want to think about what I would call human firewalls, right? So things where you balance autonomy with a person in the loop to maintain resiliency against spoofing attacks that might confuse something. I think certainly for something like swarming, yeah, you want to think really hard about how you manage your command and control so that if somebody gets in, they can't turn the swarm against you. What's it getting, you know, sort of taskings from? You don't want sort of a single point of failure. Again, it's not, to me, it's not about the likelihood of getting in, but the consequences if someone were to get in, what that could do with it.
Sir, I have a question from our streaming audience. The question is, you referred to a mix of human and machine cognition. So how do you think about that in problem situations where the data is too nuanced for computer cognition, not too voluminous for human cognition?
That's great. Yeah, so I'm going to give an example here from the field of chess, which I think is a pretty cool, interesting example. So the best chess players in the world today are not people, we know that, right? That's like 20 years old now. But they're also not machines, which is kind of interesting. They're actually human-machine teams that play together in something that people call centaur chess, which is like a cool visualization. So after Garry Kasparov lost to Deep Blue in the late 90s, he went back, one imagines probably after like a stiff drink, and invented this field of advanced chess or centaur chess, where people and machines are working together in a team. And they find that it results in a better game of chess. It results in blunder-free games because the machine can say that's a mistake, but the humans still add value in thinking about higher level strategy. So I think there are lots of situations where autonomy is better today because if you're looking at things, generally I would look at things that have an objectively right answer, right? Landing a plane safely on an aircraft carrier, driving safely from point A to point B. Those are things where autonomy is good at. You want to watch, you want to put an automated information processing algorithm on a house. Watch the house, tell me if someone comes in or comes out. We can't automate that. We should be automating that, right? But then understanding the context and the decision about what to do about things is very, very difficult. And I don't see a position where in any kind of reasonable future you would have systems that are good enough to do that, particularly in the ground environment, or that would be comfortable allowing them to do that. And so you're going to want people still making those decisions.
Dennis Bushnell, NASA. This, along with much else that we're doing in the national security, has a problem. It's called EMP. You take away the electrons, and this doesn't work so well. This was the problem with FCS, which was 23 robots connected by electrons, and we're very vulnerable. If we go to shielded and decouplers, then there's femtosecond lasers. And femtosecond lasers are small, light, cheap lasers that are terawatts to petawatts that go through and produce gammas and X-rays that go through the Faraday cages. And so that's a problem. The other problem is that this whole technology you're talking about is worldwide. The best of it is produced in Switzerland and Japan and other places. And all buyable by anybody with a credit card. So, yes, we need to do this to stay even, but I don't see the overreach.
So, I think on EMPs, it depends a little bit on what you're talking about. If you're talking about, like, nuclear-level things, in which case, you know, probably that's a different level problem versus non-nuclear EMPs, right?
This is not nuclear EMP. This is tactical EMP.
This
is flux compression generators powered by either capacitors or explosives with ever-increasing range. This is not nuclear EMP.
Yeah. So I've heard people raise some interesting things about sort of where electrically different sort of high-powered microwave and EMP technology is going, that there's potentially the ability to do some very large effects without nuclear devices. That's something that probably we would want to think about. I would say more broadly, in the types of environments and adversaries I think the Army is likely to face, I'm very concerned about just sort of cyber and electromagnetic spectrum dominance as a whole. certainly against adversaries like Russia, we should probably be concerned and thinking about their creative uses of even nuclear weapons and the ways that they're thinking about using them. But you know, just having a GPS jammer or jamming comms is not really sophisticated, and anybody can get a hold of that technology. That's something that we will face in the future. So I think that's definitely a key component. Part of it is our network that can respond and be resilient to that, but part of it is being able to fight off network, be able to fight in the blind, fight in, you know, in the dark, if we have comms that are degraded, if we have cyber attacks, being able to sort of fight through those things and keeping kind of offline backups, kind of going old school in some ways. Yes.
Sam Visner with ICF. One of the most recent and I think brilliant innovations has been the combination of geospatial intelligence with social networking, which is what Waze does, right? Provides, you know, a geospatial context, and then you have social network information in real time overlaid on that. And it works pretty well. At least it works well enough for me to use every day. Well, I'm wondering if that could be combined with the concepts that you're discussing here to give autonomous and swarming devices a level of intelligence, or at least intelligence insight, not making them intelligence, but giving them intelligence insight that would allow them to operate in an entirely different way. One thing that I'm not sure that the discussion so far has offered is the intelligence that is the information that they would use in whatever mission they're attempting to prosecute, and if advances in this field could be combined and synergized with advances in geospatial information and social networking to give these a new concept of operations and doctrine we hadn't considered yet.
That's a good one. I mean, there is, I think, a lot of potential. This is not really, I think, like an instance at all, but for tapping into this sort of very shifting landscape of social networking, social media, you know, a bottom ad raid was reported on Twitter, being able to understand that in real time, you're going to need automated tools, software tools to process that. The Boston Police Department is still going through Twitter feeds from the minutes after the Boston Marathon bombing attacks. And they're interested in finding out if they had automated tools to comb through Twitter, could they have found the bomber sooner rather than the several days it took? Understanding that social landscape to me will be critical in the kind of operations the Army's going to do in the future, regardless of what you do with it, right? Maybe you have robots responding to that, or you have people responding to it. Being able to like understand that and react to it so that we don't find out that we've lost the population, right, until it's too late, to me was really key.
Okay. This is going back to an earlier question, but we are seeing a lot of advances in neural science and how it interacts with machines. So we have brain with implant controlling prosthetics. We've got people who can communicate thought over internet and somebody else take the action based on these thoughts. If I project this 30 years down the road, can we have brain with implant talking to other brains with implant as well as machines without human being intervening in the middle as a thought process? Now, if I project that here, this could be a self-learning vehicle which says that this new entity, which is human brain with implant, is self-learning. It decides how much autonomy to give to a machine somewhere else and how much control should I exercise. And not only that, I've got other human beings acting in the same fashion. So this is now the mad scientist role, and see
right. What
you think now, about now that kind
now
of work.
Now we're living up to the mad scientist name of the conference. Good. When you say chips in people's brains, talking to chips in other people's brains, all I think of is, my God, what would Twitter look like in that world, right? How horrifying would that be? I don't want that. So I think if you see a future where I think some of the most important places to be ahead on will be in the cognitive realm in the future, right? Leveraging human cognition and automation to process information, respond to the battlefield future and faster. And the ability to sort of stay ahead of that in our adversaries will be really critical. So there's a lot of components to that. One is better autonomy, better human-machine integration, right? Making human sort of interfaces so people can understand them, better training, right? The types of people that you need to control a swarm may be different kinds of people, right? Different training, different selection processes. You know, the end point that seems really scary is we're talking about earlier about severing people's limbs and putting on prosthetic things and putting things in people's chips and heads. Technically, some of this has been done, right? People have already done some of these in labs. Would you do that to service members at some point in time in the future? It depends upon how reversible things were, how safe things are. I mean, there are things today that we can do from a drug perspective in terms of human cognitive enhancement that are safe, that are real, that are effective, that to me, like, let's start talking about that now, right? And we need to have that conversation and figure out how do we do that in a way that's ethical, that, as someone mentioned earlier, responds to the fact that we have an ethical responsibility to protect our service members. And let's not, you know, I wouldn't get sort of too scared or fixated on, like, the Frankenstein sort of vision of the future. You know, maybe there's a world where we can do that and it's safe, maybe not. I don't know.
It's possible that this kind of implant might happen because of commercial needs.
Yeah.
I just want to be
right.
Better than anybody else in the world.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
And I don't mind doing it myself.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's what's happening with our machines today.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is almost the second part of my life. And
that's right. Yeah.
It can be even more powerful.
Sir, I have one more question, if you don't mind. So this kind of follows on with the decision-making and the human in the loop. So this person writes, robotics sounds like we'll be able to make decisions faster, but faster doesn't mean better. We still need to be able to work on increasing the probability that the decision will be the right one, the Army decision, when nobody has to apologize for making, in front of Congress for making. So where's the effort to push that kind of wetware solution?
Yeah, so I think that's good. I mean, there's this balance, right? Again, some decisions have a sort of an objectively right answer, right? A person says, I want to put a mortar on that target. We want to put a guidance system on the mortar so that it hits the target, the person said. That's pretty easy. You know, driving safely, not running over people. That's kind of got a straightforward answer. Other things do not have a right answer, particularly in the kind of combat environments that the Army's in. There are some situations you could put different soldiers in the same situation. It'll come to different answers. People may disagree on what the right call was, right? Just because somebody's, you know, got a rifle in the kind of combat zones we're in today doesn't mean they're combatant. Doesn't mean that they're a lawful target. Just because someone's even an actual combatant doesn't mean it's the right thing to do to shoot them in that situation if it inflames the village and causes other, you know, those are very context-dependent situations. What's challenging for us is that line is going to keep moving as autonomy is able to do more things. But yeah, there's certainly some things that you're going to want a person to still do. I think here.
Dave Lyon, Army Research Lab. So I have a question that kind of links your talk and the previous one. So if either or both of you want to comment, that's fine. So think about field commanders in the future, right? They'll have control of a set of human assets, soldiers, traditional, but also under their control, a set of autonomous assets, which could exhibit various behaviors and levels of autonomy from the full autonomy you described on down. So from a leadership training aspect, I'm trying to think through what aspects would be critical to be more successful in that combined environment as opposed to a traditional human asset leadership.
Yeah, so one of the real big challenges as you start to incorporate more autonomy and more complexity into the system becomes more opaque to the operator, right? So you put out a landmine, you know what a landmine's gonna do. There's no question about that, right? As you get more and more autonomy, you may get situations where people don't really understand what it's gonna do. The Patriot community experienced this in 2003, right? Where you had operators that thought they were in control of the Patriot and the system was doing things that they did not anticipate. And some of those were things in one case, a fratricide on the battlefield that still people are not entirely sure what happened. In other cases, there were known flaws in the system or known failure modes, I guess I would say, but the operators either weren't poorly trained or there wasn't a culture of having sort of direct control over it. So I think that is a concern. You know, when you have people, you can have sort of a tactile sense, and good commanders can have a sense of, like, what is sort of Private Snuffy likely to do in this situation? How do I give the right guidance so they stay within parameters? Autonomous systems are different, right? They're not as robust to a wide variety of things. They exhibit brittleness where they might do really well in certain situations, then fail quite badly in others. And so getting that understanding is going to be key. Experience is a big part of it, you know, training. One of the interesting findings to me out of the Patriot community was they thought that when they had more autonomy, they would need less training. They found out that wasn't the case. You needed more training because you needed operators to be able to understand the environment, the air defense environment, and the system. And that had more demands then. Yes?
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Royal with Decisive Analytics. You talked a bit about having mass and acquiring all of these different UAVs that could all work together. And while I hear people talk about that, and I think it's generally a good idea, I don't know how well our defense acquisition system is ready for that, because you know, a Predator is a lot cheaper than an F-35, and you could make a really basic UAV, but once you add in the command and control and the network capabilities and the cyber protections, it's going to be a lot more expensive. How do you think DoD needs to change culturally and institutionally? Do you really think that this is likely in the next 5-10 years?
Yeah, okay. Likely? You know, I think the big factor is time, right? How do you compress time of that process? So whatever we build, if we build it on a 30-year timeline, we're going to be shooting behind the target because the world is going to change faster. In this particular case for the Army, where you're fighting, you know, adversaries that don't have like giant bureaucracies, they don't have JSIDs, right? But also, the environment is such where the technological barrier to entry is very low, right? You need to build a pretty sophisticated aircraft to go and fight, even fly up in the air and then fight against like the US Air Force. On the ground, you walk out of your mud hut and you got an AK-47 and you got some fertilizer to make a bomb or a propane tank and you're in the fight. That's a very different kind of world. And you know, all of the major adaptability successes over the last decade came outside of the formal process. So, you know, if that's where we need to go and we build, you know, sort of end arounds of bureaucracy, so be it. But we need the ability to institutionalize those, to retain some of those coming out of these wars. To me, the even more grave concern was all of those things, IEDs, ISR, MRAPs, required basically personal intervention by the Secretary of Defense. That is not a recipe for an adaptive institution. And that is not a good position to be in. So we need, like, processes that allow us to react on faster timelines. Was there one other thing?
No.
Are we done?
No.
Okay. All right. I think we're done on time. Thank you.